Yeah, when I'm writing, I don't think about anyone else at all. I just love what I do. When I'm writing, I'm just lost in my own world. That's the best part of my life. When I start marketing, of course, I start getting a little antsy, a little nervous. The publisher invests a fair bit of money. So he needs to make sure that, I need to make sure that he recovers his money. But I'm with Zoya Akhtar right now. So to use a cliche, mera time aa gaya hai.
You know, I mean, the way things work in the universe. So I was shooting my second film, Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara, which was in 2010. And I kept hearing murmurings of a book called Immortals of Meluha, which had released that year. And everybody was talking about it. We came back, I finished, I was editing, I read the book. And I was like, in my head, I had already started making the film. I had already cast Hrithik Roshan, Mishiva, all this was happening. And I much later, I mean, realized that there was already cat fights all over the industry for the rights. The month, I don't know if you know this, but the month that Zindagi released, you released your second book.
Really?
Yes, Secret of Nagas. It was the second book, July 2011. Right. We released it in the same month, and that's when we met, post that, at Fiki.
And I love that movie.
Yeah, thank you. So we were both on panel discussions. We were both on different panels. And that's the first time I met him. And I was with my CA agent, who also knows him. And they were like, you have to meet Amish. And I was like, yes, I do. And then I met him and I was like, so does anyone have the rights? And he was like, yes. And I was like, okay. So this time when I got called, I haven't started reading the Ramchandra series. I'm going to binge it now that the third one's coming out. I'm going to start. I've just been gifted both by him. And I'm coming in a little early this time to territory.
You know, it's even among the, it's not just among ancient Indians, even among ancient Greeks, for example, what we call a muse, right? The ancient Greeks believed that the muse was also a goddess, right? Yeah. And that it was someone who existed outside of you. So your task as a creative person was not to be arrogant and say that I am creating this. Your task was to help your muse to help you. So which means if you need to write a book, then you need to be at the laptop and you need to be working. You can't be watching a movie or doing something else. Now, just because you're doing that doesn't mean you'll get that blessing from the muse. It's just that your chances go up, right? And I think that it's a very good attitude for most creative guys to have. That is not within me, it's something outside, and it's a blessing, and I need to honor that blessing. You know, if you're a non-believer, you can believe it's a muse. If you're a believer, such as I am, you can believe it's Lord Shiva, or whichever god or goddess you worship. But have that thing that actually it's a blessing from someone outside. And you need to do what you need to do to help that blessing to come. You know, so I do what I need to do for the blessing to come. So I read a lot. All that goes in as, you know, material at the back of the head. I travel a lot. When I travel, I like to travel like locals. I don't like to travel in a bubble. So I like to eat local food, meet local people, try and learn a few local words, a few cuss words, everything, right? You get immersed in it and you learn some stuff which goes in. I listen to music while writing. I listen to tons of music while writing, and much of the music of Zindagi Na Milegi Dobara was actually used while writing Sita, by the way. Yeah. So it's, you know, the words themselves don't matter because I tune out the words. It's the mood of the music, which,
even,
you know, in some scenes it just, yeah, it just helps. And I eat lots of cream biscuits while writing. That always works like a key. Yeah. You know, I mean, he's in traditional Sanskrit storytelling style. In Sanskrit, the word for villain, what we are told, is Khalnayak. But actually, villain for Khalnayak is actually a wrong translation. That's not what Khalnayak actually means. Nayak is someone who takes the story forward. Khala means doubtful. So anyone who takes a story in a doubtful direction is the Khalnayak. It doesn't necessarily mean villain. It's just, because villain is a very loaded term, right? So, in the Valmiki Ramayana, in the original versions, he's not seen as a villain. He's the antagonist. Lord Ram is the protagonist. That's the way it is. I think that's how I have tried to portray him. There's a lovely line that the marketing guys came up with in the blurb at the back, that without the darkness, light has no purpose. And that, I think, describes Ravan, you know, to a major extent, because without a so-called villain, what would the gods do? Right? They need someone to fight. So, the greatest god needs the greatest Khalnayak. That's what makes him very interesting and exciting as a character to write about as well. He's not just a thug. He's not just someone who kills. He's a brilliant scholar. He's a brilliant musician. He's invented instruments which exist. And at least myths say that he invented those instruments which exist till today. So Rudra Veena, which is probably the best stringed instrument that one can find. That was invented by him in honor of Lord Shiva. The Raavan Hatta, the Rajasthani, I'm sure all of you must have heard of it. That was also apparently invented by him. The word Raavan Hatta means the sound of Ravan's grief. So he was a very deep guy. Massive ego also. Severe anger management issues also, obviously. But an interesting character to write about.
We grew up knowing the story and hearing the story and having it reinterpreted. So it was very interesting for me to hear what he has to say and say that there's a lot of depth to the character. Because, you know, there is, like he said, when you have such a strong hero, when you create something that's the opposite of it, or that's something that's the other part or the other side or the other whatever, it has to be as strong, you know, in a different way. And as he said, that it takes the story ahead. But when you're a child, you're just like, he kidnapped her. You know, that's the thing that sticks in your head, and you don't go beyond that. But somewhere now, when you look back and you think back at it, I think he also somewhere was weak and wanted to be liked by her. You know, he wanted to be liked. I mean, it was important to him to be liked. And I think that that's therein, even though however you demonize him, there is the human failing and a weakness which comes from the same desire to be loved and to be accepted and to be, you know.